Good evening, I'm Nicholas Hoare. London lends itself to illustration. It's extremely drawable, it's very elegant, and despite the scruff that you'll find in places like Shaftesbury Avenue, there's a great deal to be said for taking an old-fashioned sketchbook out, and I'm not an illustrator myself, and sketching and recording what one sees. There's lots to choose from. I'm about to show you a cross-section of what has come out in the past 10, 20, 30 years of books devoted to illustrating the city in various tones and shades and mediums. And it's a hodgepodge, but it's a fascinating cross-sectional view of what there is to be seen and what there is to read when it comes to seeing the lighter side of London. We'll start with a book called Frank Pick's London. Who he? Well, Frank Pick was the managing director of the London Underground. And in his heyday in the 20s and 30s, he was responsible for the iconic illustrations and designs that went into not only the graphics of the Underground, but also the shape and design and superstructure of the Underground, in conjunction with other people who were just as interesting and design-oriented as he was. He was a visionary, and he's made the design so iconic that it's still in place today, well over 100 years later. This book is called Frank Pick's London, and it is subtitled Art, Design, and the Modern City by a gentleman called Oliver Green. And the book is filled with colourful illustrations of just what it was he did, how he designed it, and the history attached to that extraordinary invention, the Underground. The Tube, as one calls it, is a legend, and so I might say is Frank Pick. Moving on, we have another view. This is called Edward Bawden's London. Now, Edward Bawden was an author as well as an illustrator. He illustrated for children's books, for grown-up books, for all sorts of books, in fact. But he also did things like posters and all sorts of literary material. And his book is just as much fun, but completely different. This is, again, devoted to London and to all its rich contents. He did a wonderful poster for the London Zoo, for example, which for those of you who know it, is the highlight of going to Regent's Park. And the backside of the book says, and I quote, "When a man is tired of London, he's tired of life, for there is in London all that life can afford." That was Samuel Johnson. Edward Bawden's London, Peyton Skipwith and Brian Webb. Sir Hugh Casson was a wonderful architect. He was also the director of the Royal Academy, and he produced, during his lifetime, a succession of books, studies, articles, illustrations, you name it, that are absolutely timeless. His medium was watercolour, and in this book, which is called Hugh Casson's London, he has a cross-section of absolute classics. And I'm going to hold this up to the light as well, because you can see the charm, the ignored charm of watercolour at its best. This is the garden house, Leighton House. This is the Natural History Museum. This is the Royal College of Music. That's the Sir John Soane Museum, which incidentally, if you haven't seen it, it's in Lincoln Inn Fields, is marvellous, well worth the detour. Tiny, cramped, you have to queue a bit, but absolutely spectacular and very odd. Then you have London Sketchbook, A City Observed, by a splendid character called Graham Byfield. Now, Graham Byfield has a variation on the Hugh Casson theme, and his illustrations are very similar, but they're rather more detailed, and they're rather richer in terms of the coloration. And as you can see here, you've got the Midland Hotel, you have Sicilian Avenue, you have Liverpool Street Station, which is still going strong, quite unchanged except for a hotel that's gone up inside, and these little village restaurants, all encapsulated in this wonderful book. But the purpose of this dissertation is a book that is absolutely brand new. And whereas these are vintage, This one is barely a month old as I'm recording this. A splendid little book by a lady called Eleanor Crow, as in bird, called The Shopfronts of London, in praise of small neighbourhood shops. This lady is a jewel. It's a sweet little book. It's available readily out here. You have no problem getting it. But she's broken it down with her inimitable drawings and sketches and watercolours into sections. So you have, for example, cafes, bakers, butchers, fish shops, stationers, and bookshops. And this one in Blackland's Terrace, I recommend hugely. If you go down the King's Road, just a hop, skip and a jump from Sloane Square Station and turn right, you're in a darling little street called Blackland's Terrace. And in it is the illustrious bookseller John Sando. Been there since 1960, I guess, something like that. Absolute institution. You can hardly get in because the books are all over the stairs, all under the stairs, all underfoot. They're stacked up to here. They're absolutely marvellous, and you'll have a hell of a time getting out of there without loading up, which means that you'll have to pay for an extra suitcase when you come home, but we won't go there. Anyway, John Sando is here, and there's the illustration. It lives up to it exactly. Now, this lady is extremely colourful and extremely accurate. And for those who really know the city, she's nailed it. She's got it absolutely down pat. And some of them, I must say, I've never heard of in my life. And I thought I knew the place fairly well. Absolutely marvelous, delightful book, Eleanor Crow, Shopfronts of London. And we seem to have a visitor here, a feline creature by the name of Pippin. And if I can get her before we come to a rather abrupt halt, we will bring her into the show. Pippin, come and show yourself. Now, this cat, for example, deserves a shop front of her own. She's a handful of old legs, as my father used to say, but she's very much part of the furniture. And I hope all of you who are looking at this idiotic performance will remember that you're in for lots more where this came from. But before we conclude, just remember Shop Fronts of London by Eleanor Crow. Don't you approve, Pippin? I'm so glad you do. Without you, what would we all do? And on that feline note, good evening.